A very warm welcome to the 2021 Ecumenical Chain of Prayer, organised by the denominational ecumenical officers of Norfolk and Waveney Churches Together. This is an annual event held in St Luke's Chapel of Norwich Cathedral during the Week of Prayer for Christian Unity. Inevitably, COVID restrictions mean that we must have a virtual offering this year. The theme for the 2021 Week of Prayer for Christian Unity is Abiding in Christ, taken from St. John chapter 15. Abide in my love, and you shall bear much fruit, which calls us to prayer, reconciliation, and unity in the church and the human family. If you're unfamiliar with the concept, the chain is formed by ministers and parishioners from churches of different denominations based in and around the city of Norwich, following on one from another, praying in line with their own traditions for God's help to reconcile and unify Christians and all members of the human family. Occasionally, the chain is broken if a slot is not taken. But this year, as the contributions have been pre-recorded and edited together, the chain is complete. The provisional date for the 2022 Chain of Prayer is Thursday, the 20th of January. Do please get in touch if you would like to take part. Contact email addresses are available on our website, Norfolk and Waveney Churches Together.
Welcome. My name is the Reverend Canon Julian Pursehouse, and I would like to welcome you this morning to this ecumenical chain of prayer in January 2021. As you will be well aware, this year's chain of prayer has migrated online, as many other things have done over the last 12 months, because of the viral pandemic and the need for us to be safe and take care of our physical well-being. But along with our physical well-being, we also have a care for our spiritual well-being. And this year's material for the Week of Prayer for Christian Unity reminds us of our need to be dwelling richly in the love of Christ. So the theme for this year's ecumenical prayer is Abiding in Christ. And the resource material has been prepared by the Grand Champ monastic community in Switzerland. Through this material, we are invited into the deep solitude of abiding in Christ, a place of deep resting and faithful love, where we find life and the capacity to love our world as Christ loved. The material this year offers us something uniquely precious, an opportunity to engage with a form of prayer that is both very ancient and yet at the same time potentially very relevant and therapeutic in these challenging times. Abiding in Christ is an inner attitude of prayerful serenity that takes root and flourishes over a lifetime. It is one that demands space and time to grow. Clearly, it can be overtaken by the struggle for the necessities of life and is easily threatened by the many distractions, noise, activity, and challenges of everyday life. But when we abide in Christ, when we find the deep resources of love, for we are resting in the presence of perfect love, in the life and spirit of the one who is abiding in the Father's love. Here is the one who longs for us to abide in the divine life and become friends with the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit in a communion of love. And so in John chapter 15, verse 9, the Gospel writer says, As the Father has loved me, so I have loved you. Abide in my love. If we turn to the Gospels in the New Testament, we discover that part of the regular pattern of Christ in his earthly life was to turn away from the demands of life and ministry and seek prayerful solitude. So, for example, in the early part of Mark's Gospel, we read that early one morning before sunrise, Jesus withdrew to a quiet place, to a mountain, to seek solitude and prayerful contemplation in the presence of God. His busy and demanding ministry amongst the people of his day is punctuated by this pattern of withdrawal and prayerful silence. One of our traditional hymns, Dear Lord and Father of Mankind, picks up this rhythm of prayerful solitude, particularly in the words of verse 3. I share these words with you and I invite you to listen. O Sabbath rest by Galilee, O calm of hills above, where Jesus knelt to share with thee the silence of eternity interpreted by love. So this year, in these disturbing times, we are invited to find that same rhythm of prayerful solitude and discover the riches of Christ's love. We do so amongst all God's people in time and space. This abiding in Christ connects us to our sisters and brothers in many different traditions that form the rich tapestry of the body of Christ. As we seek reconciliation, justice, and peace in a troubled world, we do so with all God's people, and we discover the value of working together as God's people in unity of spirit. As those who are dwelling in Christ, we seek to be agents of kindness, channels of hope, conduits of calm, and beacons of compassion. I wonder, can we nurture that still centre of deep peace at the very heart of our lives, the touching place between heaven and earth, where we encounter the presence of perfect love? The Welsh poet and priest R.S. Thomas was someone who knew what it was to struggle with that encounter with the presence of God in the deep interior of his own being. And he often gave voice to this in his poetry throughout his lifetime. In his poem entitled The Bright Field, Thomas highlights the need for us to turn aside and become deeply attentive to the inner voice of God. I read this poem now, and I invite you to listen to the words. I have seen the sun break through to illuminate a small field for a while, and gone my way and forgotten it. But that was the pearl of great price, the one field that had treasure in it. I realise now that I must give all that I have to possess it. Life is not hurrying on to a receding future, nor hankering after an imagined past. It is the turning aside, like Moses, to the miracle of the lit bush, to a brightness that seemed as transitory as your youth once, but is the eternity that awaits you. I do hope and pray that throughout this day, as you share in this ecumenical chain of prayer, that you will feel truly blessed as you join together with the prayers of all God's people in the body of Christ, and that you will begin to cherish what it is to abide in Christ and to love the world as Christ loved it to. May God bless you richly this day and all your days. Amen.
Jesus said, "Abide in me as I abide in you. Just as the branch cannot bear fruit by itself unless it abides in the vine, neither can you unless you abide in me. I am the vine, you are the branches. Those who abide in me and I in them bear much fruit, because apart from me you can do nothing." As we join together in this week of prayer for Christian unity, we pray that Christians throughout the world may come together to seek justice, harmony, and peace. Jesus Christ, you seek us, you wish to offer us your friendship and lead us to a life that is ever more complete. Grant us the confidence to answer your call so that we may be transformed and become witnesses of your tenderness for the world. Holy God, may your will be done. Loving God, may we receive in our hearts the presence of Christ and cherish it as a secret of love. Nourish our prayer. Enlighten our reading of the scripture. Act through us so that the fruits of your gifts can patiently grow in us. Holy God, may your will be done. God our Father, you reveal to us your love through Christ and through our brothers and sisters. Open our hearts so that we can welcome each other with our differences and live in forgiveness. Grant us to live united in one body so that the gift that is each person comes to light. May all of us together be a reflection of the living Christ. Holy God, may your will be done. Lord Jesus, your entire life was prayer, perfect harmony with the Father. Through your Spirit, teach us to pray according to the will of love. May the faithful of the whole world unite in intercession and praise, and may your kingdom of love come. Holy God, may your will be done. Thrice holy God, we thank you for having created and loved us. We thank you for your presence in us and in creation. May we learn to look upon the world as you look upon it with love. In the hope of this vision, may we be able to work for a world where justice and peace flourish for the glory of your name. Holy God, may your will be done. Merciful Father, accept these prayers for the sake of your Son, our Saviour, Jesus Christ. Amen.
Hi, this is the Reverend Marc Palmer, continuing St. Margaret's Drayton, continuing our insert into the week of prayer of Christian unity. I'm going to attempt to explore contemplative intercession. I've not done it before, but I've felt a keenness to do that. The scriptural phrase is, "Abide in me as I abide in you." The framework for contemplative intercession that I'm going to suggest: who or what am I being asked to pray for today? You might want to make simple prayers. You might simply want to just name people, places, or situations. You might move from there in the silence towards the use of a prayer word. Jesus, Shalom, Abba, and so forth. Or you might use the Jesus prayer. Lord Jesus Christ, Son of God, have mercy on me, a sinner. Or you might simply give way to abiding, trusting that the very ache within you is being read, that Spirit is calling to Spirit. That you might let go and abide in these 5 minutes. Abide in me as I abide in you. Lord Jesus, we come to abide in you, alone and together as the body of Christ. So we pray. Abide in me as I abide in you. Abide in me as I abide in you. abide in me as I abide in you. Dear Lord, we offer to you those people, places, situations, our churches together, our rootedness and life in you. Amen and amen.
Welcome to this segment that forms part of the Ecumenical Chain of Prayer for 2021. My name is Darren Woodward and I lead Oak Grove Community Church just on the north side of Norwich. Now I've got about 10 minutes to lead us through some thoughts and reflections even, and also having some space for us to pray. So I guess I better crack on. This year's theme is abiding in Christ. And for me, in order to abide, I have to make an intentional decision to pause, to stop, to submit and to surrender all of those conflicting thoughts that just whirl around my head, all those things that I simply have got to get done today. And also have to trust that God is actually big enough to handle them for a few moments while I, just like in that amazing story of Mary and Martha, choose the better thing, like Mary did, and come and sit at the feet of the Lord Jesus Christ. So as we start, can I invite you to get comfortable? Come and sit with me for a moment. You may want to close your eyes, because, you know, that's why we get kids to close their eyes, put their hands together when we pray, is that that's one less thing to be distracted by, isn't it? So you might want to just close your eyes. And the other thing you might want to do, that rather than putting your hands together, you might just want to put your hands out. Just open your palms up, just in a way, just declaring that, you know, you want to receive from God. You want to receive his Holy Spirit. So eyes closed, palms open. And the other thing you might find helpful is, just as you do that, is just to silently repeat a phrase over and over a few times. Something like, come Lord Jesus, or maybe be still and know that I am God. Just something that will help you just kind of home in on Jesus just for these few moments. So let's do that, shall we? Let's close our eyes, open up our palms, and just center on Jesus just for a few moments. As humans, we are pretty sociable creatures, generally. Now, of course, there's going to be an exception to that. There always is, isn't there? There's always an exception to every rule. But I believe that generally we thrive on connection and interaction with others. The pandemic that we've been in and are still in has made face-to-face connection with others challenging. And actually, at times, it's made it pretty impossible. With all of us having to revert to technology to keep those connections alive. It might be video calling friends and relatives. It may be in lieu of our Sunday morning or other time of the week gatherings that we've had to do those online in some form. So maybe using YouTube or Facebook Live or some other medium. But the fact is that we've had to be even more intentional about being with others, even in this sort of virtual space that we've suddenly inhabited. The truth is that Jesus wants connection with us too. Pandemic or not, he wants a relationship with us. He wants to spend time with us and us to spend time with him, simply hanging out and enjoying his company. But that doesn't just happen. We have to create the space. We have to create the margin in our busy lives and commit to spending time with him. One of my absolute favourite passages in the Bible comes at the end of Matthew 11, where Jesus says, "Come away with me, all of you who are weary and burdened, and I will give you rest." Are you feeling weary today? A bit run down? Perhaps operating at less than what you think your full capacity is? Maybe you're burdened. Yeah, we continue to live in strange times, don't we? Both mentally and emotionally, life is tough right now. It's hard to cope, you know, just with doing whatever's become normal. It's tough, let alone adding in all those other frustrations of what we can do, what we can't do, and how that in turn, in this sort of vicious circle, affects all those other seemingly everyday things that previously we just took for granted. Importantly, Jesus ended that verse I just referred to with the promise. He said, "I will give you rest." And that passage continues with Jesus offering to walk with us, walk alongside us, shouldering the load, sharing the burden right with us. It's reminiscent of the psalmist's reflections in Psalm 23 that the Good Shepherd restores our soul. And Jesus frequently made time to get away with his dad. You know, reading the Gospels, it's a repeating theme that he got up early and withdrew to pray, or he just took himself off to pray, to spend time with God. The disciples even got quite grumpy on a couple of occasions when they couldn't find him. Oh, he's off praying again. Jesus knew that he needed constant soul restoration, and he got that from abiding with his Father. I don't think we're any different. You know, in order to make sense of our lives, our world, and the part that we need to play in that, we need to get away, abide with Christ on a regular basis, so that we may declare that it's well with our souls. As this is the ecumenical chain of prayer, it'd be good for us to spend a little bit of time just praying at the end here. So I'm going to leave a couple of minutes now for you to reflect on just those words I've briefly shared. Perhaps take this time to give over to God your weariness, your cares, your worries, your burdens, and accept his gift of rest as you choose to intentionally abide with him. Praying is as much speaking as it is listening. So speak out your prayers by all means wherever you are. But also perhaps give God some time, because he might just have something to say to you in the middle of it. Let's just take a couple of minutes just now, just on our own, just to pray, to reflect, to listen, to abide with Jesus. Just as we come to the end of our time together now, I just want to thank you for watching, listening, and participating. Thank you for taking that intentional decision to pause, to stop, and perhaps even abide, however fleetingly, with Jesus. My hope in prayer is that you would know the tangible presence of the Holy Spirit and his impact on your life, and that in choosing to abide and to collaborate with the Lord of all, that you'll know his rest today and every day.
When I became a Christian in my teens, I was very zealous, very judgmental, and I thought I knew what was right and what was wrong, and that I knew the Bible far more than anybody else, although the reality was, of course, that I didn't. And then I went to stay at a community of Franciscans for a very short time. And just before I left, I was doing the washing up with a brother there. And he said this to me. He said, "Julian, when you leave, always remember to listen and love. Listen to those who you might disagree with and love them." And I think as we pray, my first suggestion for us all is to stop and experience the love of God. To be quiet before the Lord for a while and know that you are loved. And when I experience the suffering in the world, when I see suffering, I know that if I don't spend time simply being quiet before the Lord and listening to him, I become frustrated or annoyed. My family will tell you that I need to spend time with the Lord to come back and experience his healing for me to then go out and love others. So abide in his love for a while and listen to him, to his promptings. What is he asking you to do? Jesus said, "Love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your strength and with all your mind." Experience his love and then open our hearts to others, to listen and reflect on what people are saying and how should we respond. We can be so good at knee-jerk reactions and responses. But at Christian Aid, we've learned to truly listen to communities, to local people, and to find out what is best for them from their own lips. Of course, we do respond quickly in emergencies, and we have to respond very quickly. But if we're going to make a long-term difference, we need to understand the needs of the communities. What will make that difference? And so, as opposed to simply giving people food, how can we enable people to grow their own food? As opposed to giving people simply money, how can we enable people to make their own income? And likewise, helping people who are thirsty by building reservoirs that will last in the long term to provide water. But if we are truly going to listen and love people who are suffering in some way, who are in need in some way, as Desmond Tutu once said, if you keep pulling people out of the river, at some point you're going to have to go upstream and find out why people are falling in the first place and challenge that. We often see in the prophets in the Old Testament God speaking through them against injustice, against the causes of poverty, against those things that were actually keeping people in poverty. So in terms of Amos, for example, we read this. "Hear this, you that trample on the needy and bring to ruin the poor of the land, saying, When will the new moon be over so that we may sell grain, and the Sabbath so that we may offer wheat for sale? We will make the ephah small and the shekel great, and practice deceit with false balances, buying the poor for silver and the needy for a pair of sandals, and selling the sweepings of the wheat." In other words, how can we become richer at the expense of people living in poverty? And when we love somebody, we don't keep treating the symptoms. We want to find out what is the cause of their illness and how can we get rid of that. It's often not the most popular thing to do, to challenge injustice. To paraphrase Dom Helder Camara, when we feed the hungry, people often applaud us. But when we ask why they are hungry and challenge people to do something about it, then we come in for criticism. Last year, when I was travelling in remote areas of Ethiopia, meeting communities who have suffered drought in the past or are suffering drought now, people said, we don't need people to tell us about climate change. We know there is climate change. And they wanted to know, having seen their livestock die, having seen loved ones die through drought, why people in power were not doing much about it in their eyes. One woman said this, we used to think it was just here that the seasons were changing. The sun is getting hotter and the drought's worse. We have seen our children die. We have seen our cattle die. Don't those people care that they are changing the seasons? Do they want to be the only ones left? What kind of people are they? And of course, having heard these stories, I feel compelled. I'm not innocent anymore. I need to do something about it. So, after listening and loving, we need to act and to do something. And as we pray today, perhaps we can consider in our own lifestyles what we can change. But more than that, we can consider how can we speak truth to power? How can we have that prophetic voice with our MPs, with multinational companies, with people who can make a huge difference? How can we do that? And if you go on the Christian Aid website, you'll find ways of doing that. But I need to listen. I need to love and I need to act against injustice. One of the reasons that I started working for Christian Aid was because of an invitation I received to go to Phnom Penh in Cambodia and to look at some projects over there. And as I walked around the community in which I was living, which was incredibly poor, people would call it a slum community, I met this young woman who had some children, and they were incredibly thin, and their children's growth was stunted because of malnutrition. And she'd been hurt by her husband, and she had nothing in the kind of like a shed on stilts. She had nothing materially. And she told me through a translator about this time when she was really ill. She was sweating profusely, she was bleeding, and she needed help. And one of her children went running and found somebody who they knew was a Christian and asked for help. And he came running to see her. And he put her over her shoulder, over his shoulder, and he walked out of the community and put her gently onto his moped and went to a health clinic that was nearby. And they asked him for money to help her, and he didn't have any money. And eventually they agreed to treat her if he gave his blood, some of his blood, for a blood transfusion. Now in that community at that time particularly, it was a thing of stigma to do, but also it was a dangerous thing because of the lack of hygiene in the health clinics nearby and dirty needles. But nevertheless, he gave some of his blood to save her life, and she's living today. So after listening and loving, we must act against injustice. And the sad truth is that many slums are cleared by private companies, essentially, who want to build hotels in Phnom Penh and people's homes are set on fire simply so that people can get richer, many of whom live far away from that country. So, in 2019, it was estimated that approximately 52 million children under five were suffering from malnutrition, physical wasting, low weight for their height, many babies born with a low birth weight. Fantastic that that number is reducing hugely, but the reality is for those people right now, they need help. So in your prayers today, listen to what God might be saying to you. Experience his love and work out ways that you can show love to others, not only in responding by giving food, valuable though that is, and money, but also by challenging the causes of that poverty. As Micah said, what does he require of us? To do justice, to love kindness, and to walk humbly with our God.
Welcome. My name is the Reverend Beth Powney, and I'm one of the regional ministers for the Eastern Baptist Association. And I'm pleased to share this reflection with you today about abiding in Christ. So as we come to today's reflection, I want to take you to the opening verses of Psalm 91, verses 1 and 2. And here it is in the Authorised Version, which is not a version I often go back to, but I do like the way that these verses are rendered here. He that dwelleth in the secret place of the Most High shall abide under the shadow of the Almighty. Such familiar verses to us, I think. But in the more modern NRSV, it's put this way. You who live in the shelter of the Most High, who abide in the shadow of the Almighty, will say to the Lord, my refuge, my fortress, my God, in whom I trust. In both of these renditions, we have the encouragement that when we shelter with the Almighty, we will also be abiding under the shadow of the Almighty. My understanding of this is if that you choose to dwell with God under his mighty shadow, the mighty shadow of his love, then you will be abiding with him as you remain in his love, as we also read about this in those lovely verses in John 15. So in order to abide with him, we do actually have to choose to dwell or live with him. That is our choice. Let me bring you an example. As you can see, I'm very fair complexioned and fair skinned, and therefore I am easily sunburnt. When I'm on a summer picnic, which is a dream away at present, I will always head for the largest tree for the shelter from the sun. I seek out the protection of those broad spreading branches and their leaves. I choose to dwell there and stay where the tree will therefore shelter me. This for me is a great image of how I abide with God when I choose to dwell with him. It is my choice to go under the tree. It's my choice to dwell with God, and then I abide with him. I stay within his protection and refuge. Equally, I could make the choice to sit in the blazing sun and become vulnerable to its rays on my fair skin. But for me, sitting under the protection of the tree means that I can appreciate the warmth of the sun while being protected from the harm of the sun. So I choose to abide there in safety. It is our choice. The words of this psalm invite us in with Almighty God. What a privilege to place ourselves under the shadow of his wings, under the feathers of his feet, under the mighty shield like a warrior standing over us. Here are just a few of the images that are used in the rest of the psalm, promising that there will be his mighty protection when we choose to abide with him. So too with Christ as followers of Jesus, he promises to share our burdens. He says his yoke is light. He promises to protect us from the storms as he sits in the boat with us. He promises to restore and renew us through his work on the cross. All of this is when we abide with him and remain under his love and grace. So returning to my imagery of the tree with its great spreading branches, which I used earlier as an image of Almighty God's protection when we abide with him, I wonder too whether we can use this as an image of his church. As we pray this week about our unity in Christ, with each of us coming from our very many church traditions, I wonder, can we unite in the desire for the church to be a place of safety, refuge and sanctuary, as my mighty tree is to me on this scorching hot day? As life batters and wounds so many, can we as the universal church spread our arms wide to be the ones who invite and welcome the marginalised, the broken, the poor, for them to take shelter in our churches, which is as much about the people as the buildings, and in that place to experience the goodness of God, the love of God, as they abide with us, and more than that, discover the transforming grace of abiding in Christ, so that they too may be able to own the words that God is my refuge and my fortress, my God in whom I trust. This is my prayer for us all as followers of Jesus and as part of the worldwide church, that we would have open hearts, open doors, open arms, wide to invite and not to exclude, because we are the sisters and brothers who are already abiding in Christ. And we have so much to share. May the mighty power of the Holy Spirit lead you as you pray and reflect this week. Thank you.
Welcome to the ruin of St. Michael and All Angels here in Bothall. Christian worship has been offered on this site for over 900 years. Next door is the modern church of Bothall, and here we have four different Christian traditions in one, a sign of Christian unity. But here, this church, that, as I say, has been here for 900 years, in this place, it is a sign of disunity when Christians disagree. This was part of a once magnificent church rebuilt in 1304 and dedicated to St. Michael and All Angels. When Christians disagree, whatever tradition we're from, we're saying to God, choose between us, choose between your children. Is that what we really want to say to God? And that's why prayer for Christian unity is so important. Well, today we're going to focus our prayer in four different areas. Firstly, we're going to have a reflection, then a Bible reading, then a prayer, and then silence. So we begin our time of prayer reflecting on abiding in Christ and his great love for us. We're invited to share in prayer and silence together. This theme of abiding in Christ's love is apt for this time, well, for all time. It was the Catholic Dutch priest Henri Nouwen who spoke about belonging in Christ, about being beloved of God. And it's there that we start, that sense of belonging to God, that we are one in Christ. Certainly during this time of pandemic, we need to recognize that we need each other. We all have different gifts, and therefore, in needing one another, we recognize that first and foremost,
We need Christ to abide in him. Jesus said, I have given them the glory that you gave me, that they may be one as we are one, I in them and you in me. May they be brought to complete unity, to let the world know that you sent me and have loved them even as you have loved me. Let's pray. Lord Jesus, we thank you that on the cross you opened your arms of love to all people. Open our hearts to your love in this time. Bring a revelation of your presence and your love and our place within it by your Holy Spirit, that we may truly abide in you for your glory's sake. Amen. And now a moment of silence. Our second reflection is on the visible unity of God's people. In his book, Streams of Living Water, Richard Foster writes that the streams of the Holy Spirit are like a weaver's threads. While denominations go one way, the streams of the Holy Spirit interweave across those denominations. I believe that in our day, those streams of the Holy Spirit are being brought together. Those six main movements of the Holy Spirit in history are converging. The contemplative stream, the holiness stream, the charismatic stream, the social justice stream, the evangelical stream, and the incarnational stream. It's a book I highly recommend. These streams, which for so long have been isolated one from another, which have caused in some ways disunity. Now the Holy Spirit is causing us to recognize that they are all part of his work. So whichever tradition or stream we are from, let's recognize that united together, people will see the gospel at work, whichever stream we come from. We read these words in John 7. Jesus said, on the last and greatest day of the feast, Jesus said in a loud voice, if anyone is thirsty, let him come to me and drink. Whoever believes in me, as the scripture has said, streams of living water will flow from within him. By this he meant the Spirit, whom those who believed in him were later to receive. Let's pray. Lord Jesus, we thank you for one another, the traditions and streams that we come from, and the uniting Holy Spirit that you've poured out on us. You called us to be in complete unity as you are united with the Father. Forgive our disunity, and set us free to discover that we are one in you. May your Holy Spirit refresh us and cause us to recognize one another for your glory's sake. Amen. A time of silent prayer. Thirdly, our focus is on the unity of all people and all creation. We live in an ever-increasing time of isolation, not just in terms of lockdown, but in terms of loneliness. It was Mother Teresa who said, "The greatest disease in the West today is not TB or leprosy, It is being unwanted, unloved, and uncared for. We can cure physical diseases with medicine, but the only cure for loneliness, despair, and hopelessness is love. As Christians, we know the Lord of love, Jesus Christ, who in love gave his life for us. It was Dorothea of Gaza, the 6th century monk, who once said, "Imagine the world is a circle, that God is the centre, and the radii are the different ways human beings live. When those who wish to come closer to God walk towards the centre of the circle, they come closer to one another at the same time as to God. The closer they come to God, the closer they come to one another. And the closer they come to one another, the closer they come to God." We hear these words in Psalm 24. "The earth is the Lord's and everything in it, the world and all who live in it." Let's pray. Lord Jesus, we thank you for one another, for the rich variety of peoples and cultures on this planet, for the rich variety of wildlife and habitats. Forgive us for alienating one another and destroying the planet. Teach us your ways of caring, that we may care for one another and for creation, just as you care for us. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Again, we have now a time of silence. Thank you for joining me in this week of prayer for Christian unity and on this ecumenical day of prayer. May the Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord look on you with kindness and give you peace. Amen.
Hello, my name is Reverend Dean Akrell from Sproston Church. That's St. Mary and St. Margaret's, and also St. Cuthbert's. And we're going to think a bit about St. Cuthbert's now. St. Cuthbert's was built in 1886 to serve the more industrial area of Sproston, which was dominated by brick making. St. Cuthbert's is the daughter church of the much posher St. Mary and St. Margaret's. And so it was intended that the industrial workforce should attend St. Cuthbert's. Because St. Cuthbert's is a chapel of ease, it's not under the same sort of restrictions as the parish church. As a result, St. Cuthbert's has changed a lot over the years. It's proved to be a flexible space, which is adaptable to changes in community and changes of use.
You could say that St. Cuthbert's has always been on the cusp of change, much like the saint whose name we bear, Cuthbert, the early Celtic saint. St. Cuthbert was born in the year 635 in the ancient kingdom of Northumbria. It's said that when he was a young boy tending sheep, he saw a vision of St. Aidan being carried to heaven by angels. And it was at this point that Cuthbert dedicated his life to God and knew that he would lead a monastic life. Later, he became abbot of Melrose before becoming bishop of Lindisfarne. And it's Lindisfarne where his statue is today. It was a time of great change for Christianity in this country, turning away from Ireland towards creating a new frontier. You could say that Cuthbert was a pioneer minister, something which is coming back into vogue today. He was exploring new territory, being a shepherd for the people. He was well sought after as a spiritual guide, and he had a special compassion for the poor. Towards the end of his life, Cuthbert became a hermit, focusing on God's will both for him and for the world. We share in the prayer life of Cuthbert, seeking God's will for us and for the wider church and for all God's people. We're in the midst of a changing community. Sproston is growing and expanding, becoming more diverse. And at these times, it's good to think about how the church needs to change, how we too are pioneers from whatever tradition we come from. Let us pray. Lord of every mountaintop, take us back to the rough plain to discover your presence in ways far beyond our limited imaginings. Loving Lord, Christ of the pilgrim path, you recognize our many gifts, even when we do not see them ourselves. May your enabling spirit free up our creativity in worship and in everyday living. Amen.
I'm holding here an awkward-looking Christian goal which I've just made. I didn't use the beautiful red tape. I've used wool, which represents a bandage with the blood of, with the love of God binding together a hurting world, binding the wounds of a hurting world. And I've used the black wool representing all the gloominess, unpleasantness, and suffering of the world. And I've put the four seasons, which were not so pleasant this year, full of trauma. And on the sticks, I've tried to put the colors of the fruits of the Spirit, which are sustaining us at a time as this. As Paul wrote to the Galatians, he encouraged them to bear the fruits of the Spirit, which are love, joy, peace, long-suffering, gentleness, goodness, faith, meekness, temperance. I felt there's a story to this, and of course we've got a light, a candle which is going to represent the light of Christ that's shining and calming us in a world full of pain and suffering. Let us pray. Merciful Father, we pray at a time as this, help us to see you, feel you, as your people who are hurting. We are struggling to understand what is going on. The pandemic on its own, it's a disaster, was a disaster, and will still be a disaster to us all. We therefore do not need any more pain and suffering from our fellow human beings fighting for power, fighting for possessions of this world. We are already scared, scarred, fragile, and vulnerable from all the happenings of this year. We are still tender and hurting. We are calling upon your holy name, Father, for healing and binding of our wounds. We pray, Heavenly God, for the whole world, who are trying to make sense of what is happening, For Jesus warned us, stay alert, watch and pray all the time. We pray for a peaceful world that's full of love and kindness. There's no need for unnecessary fights and conflicts. We praise your holy name, God. We praise your holy name, Father, as we seek to be comforted. We pray, Heavenly God, for healing, reconciliation, for understanding of each other, for peace, for unity, and for love. We say all this, Heavenly God, in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen.
A prayer for renewed understanding of the Bible. Almighty God, you speak and bring what is good into being. You said, let there be light, and there was light. Creator God, you said, let us make human beings in our image to be like us. You also said we may eat the fruit of all trees except the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. If you eat its fruit, you are sure to die. Lord, deaf to your ears, we all take and eat. Sovereign Lord, we pray for those who govern but too often desire personal power, wealth and recognition, and who, seeking godlike wisdom, eat more fruit of knowing good and evil, who bite its rotten core, releasing pips that spread its evil, careless of the pain to their nation, people and our climate. Lord, around the world, the ears and eyes of people young and old are filled with misinformation, half-truth and lies, carried by mobile phones, tablets, TV and newspapers, all often passed on unchecked. Grant us a firmer grip on the truth and hope found in Jesus to stand these tests of modern life. Almighty Father, thank you for speaking through men and women like us in Jewish scripture, which Jesus knew, read, quoted, and prayed over, leading him to understand and carry out your calling, Father, to be Israel's Messiah and your word of life for us made flesh. Holy Spirit, help all who translate and distribute the Bible in the language of peoples who do not yet know you, or who are too poor to gain the gift of reading. Bless those who join faith and sound knowledge to technology to help us hear, view, read and understand the Bible on our phones and laptops. Lord, unite and guide your followers to bring life and hope to those around us as we explore your living word, seeking tested and lived truth to meet the challenges facing our world in your good power. We ask these prayers.
Father God, when we look with Christ-like eyes, listen with Christ-like ears, and feel with hearts made sensitive by his love, the world around us seems so full of pain and suffering. So many people are powerless against the problems they face each day. We pray for those facing the full force of nature through earthquakes, floods and droughts, through winter cold and scorching summer heat. Help of the helpless, reach out to strengthen and support. Many lives are blighted by armed conflict, civil war, tribal hatred, religious persecution and terrorism. We pray for them and the thousands who flee their homes in fear of their lives, leaving everything they have behind. We pray for all who are exploited or abused by others, those who are homeless, hungry, addicted, those suffering through illness, either mental or spiritual, those who are lonely, depressed or bereaved, and those who cannot find work. Help of the helpless, reach out to strengthen and support. We bring before you those known to us personally who are in special need at this time. help of the helpless, reach out to strengthen and support. Father, we have prayed to you for the needy of our world. We also pray for those individuals and organisations that work tirelessly to meet the needs of so many. We pray especially for those who do so at great personal risk to themselves. Help of the helpless, reach out to strengthen and support. Through Christ, we have not only made these prayers, but we offer ourselves, listening for the Spirit's prompting as to what we can do to be Christ-like to a hurting world. Help of the helpless, reach out to strengthen and support. Amen.
Good morning. My name is Sally Wallace-Jones. I am the curate in a little place in deepest, darkest Norfolk called Hingham, and I'm also the faith trustee for the Diocese of Norwich Mothers Union, and I'm delighted to be able to speak to you today about Christian unity. One of the things that I really like about the Mothers Union and about being a member of the Mothers Union is that we all come together to do good things. It doesn't matter what bit of Christianity we come from, we all come into one place together. And we worship together and we work together for good. And I think that's what I really want to make one of the cores of my message today about Christian unity. What is unity? Well, it is that coming together, irrespective of our differences, to do the things that we've been asked to do and taught to do by Jesus and by God as he gave Jesus as the gift of his Son. And I was thinking a bit about unity and what actually stops it happening. Why are we not very good at being unified? I think one of the main reasons for that is to do with fear. I think we're often afraid of things that we see being different from how we do things, so we get worried about them, and that makes us become a bit entrenched in what it is we do. And something else that a very wise old priest shared with me right at the beginning of my journey towards ordination was about pride. He said, and I think he had hit the nail exactly on the head, that hurt pride is often at the bottom of a lot of the problems and the divisions that we face. So I think it's those two things that often divide us from each other. And that made me get to thinking a little bit about who we think we are. Who do we identify as? Well, we all identify as Christians, but there are so many different groups that we could think about as being Christian. I started making a bit of a list. I came up with about 15 different names, including things like Presbyterian, Episcopalian, Anglican, Anglo-Catholic, Catholic, Methodist, Baptist, Orthodox of various different branches, including the Coptic Church and the Greek Church. There are so many different ways that we identify ourselves as Christians and different ways that we do things. And I think sometimes that feeling of identifying and labelling ourselves is part of what stops us from being a unified church. So there are divisions among us. And those are the sorts of things that we struggle with, that I think sometimes don't necessarily make the church look terribly appealing to the outside world. But we do have the joy and the privilege of one immensely unifying factor, something that binds us or should bind us all together, and that is love. In the letter of John, it says, "Perfect love drives out fear." So as we are in this week of Christian unity, it's my prayer that we will come together in love, and that perfect love will drive out the fear of difference, so that we can be the church of God, God's hands and feet and voice on earth, because that's what we're called to do. And we have some amazingly good and wonderful and supportive Bible passages to encourage us with that. One of the most famous about love, of course, is from 1 Corinthians 13. I'm just going to share a little of that with you now. "If I speak in the tongues of men or of angels, but do not have love, I am only a resounding gong or a clanging cymbal. If I have the gift of prophecy that can fathom all mysteries and all knowledge, if I have faith that can move mountains, but do not have love, I am nothing. If I give all I possess to the poor and give over my body to hardship that I may boast, but do not love, I gain nothing. Love is patient. Love is kind. It does not envy. It does not boast. It is not proud. It does not dishonour others. It is not self-seeking. It is not easily angered. It keeps no record of wrongs. Love does not delight in evil, but rejoices in the truth. It always protects, always trusts, always hopes, always perseveres. Love never fails. Where there are prophecies, they will cease. Where there are tongues, they will be stilled. Where there is knowledge, it will pass away. For we know in part and prophesy in part. But when completeness comes, what is in part disappears. When I was a child, I talked like a child. I thought like a child. I reasoned like a child. When I became a man, I put the ways of childhood behind me. For now we see only as a reflection in a mirror. Then we shall see face to face. Now I know in part. Then I shall know fully, even as I am fully known. And now these things remain, faith, hope, and love. But the greatest of these is love. So while we seek for unity, I think that passage speaks to me of not holding a record of wrongs, not delighting in evil, but of bringing each other into God's presence. And I'd like to share a little story with you that really touched me at the time and has remained with me for a period of nearly 30 years about coming together in love. I was lucky enough in the late 80s and early 90s to spend a lot of time living and working in Egypt. Had a lot of Christian friends there, including members of the congregation at All Saints Cathedral in Cairo, but also amongst the Coptic community. And it was my real privilege at Christmas 1992 to worship on Christmas Eve with my mum in the cathedral, in All Saints Cathedral in Cairo. It was a bad year for us. It was the year that we lost my dad. And it was a sad Christmas in many ways. But we had had our faith to support us. And we decided that we would go to All Saints for the Christmas Eve service. And I listed a lot of people there different earlier on of different types of Christians. So the Cathedral at All Saints has many different types of Christians worshipping there. It's essentially an Anglican foundation, but many people find their way there to worship. And many people find their way there from all sorts of different nations and countries. There were many people who were refugees from Sudan and Ethiopia and Eritrea. There were American Episcopalians who were serving there at the cathedral. There were French and Germans. There were people from some of the archaeological and diplomatic missions from all over the world. And we sat in the darkness and the warmth, just candlelit warmth of the cathedral. It was a cold night. And it was quite a dangerous place to be. There were some armed guards outside because it's a very obvious place where perhaps the dislike of Christianity or just the dislike of organised faith draws attention to itself. And the service went on. It was very beautiful. It was a Christmas Eve service. It was lovely. We came to the moment to say the Lord's Prayer together. And the pastor invited each of us to say it in our own home language. Don't know if you've ever experienced that happening to you. But as we began to pray, and there were some 30 different languages going on in the church, each of us in our own language, in the language of our childhood, in the language in which we grew in our faith, there was such a powerful sense of the Holy Spirit descending on us, and of calm and of peace and of joy and of love filling that building. It didn't matter which branch of Christianity we identified ourselves as being from. And it didn't matter which language we were using. We were all saying the same thing to our loving Father in our own words, in the words he gave us, but in our own language. It was a moment of supreme unity and joy that I will always remember, always appreciate, always be grateful for. So these days, when I get a little despairing about how we'll ever manage to pull together to be God's church on earth and not in lots of different directions because we can't agree with each other, I'm reminded of that moment. I'm reminded of that time and how in that brief space, all those divisions were gone. All that mattered was that we were praying in the words that Jesus taught us. It was such a special and important thing. One of the things I began by saying was that perfect love drives out fear. And in that moment, I would say that there felt like perfect love among us. So it's my prayer as we come into this week of Christian unity that we will find ways to pray together, to work together, to put aside our differences, and to speak to our God with one voice, so that we truly can become his church and his people on earth. Every blessing to you. Bye-bye.
Hello, my name is Eleanor, and I'm representing the Norwich branch of the Guild of Health and St Raphael. In 2015, the National Guild of the Health and St Raphael was formed by joining two organisations that had existed since 1904. The Guild is made up of people in both local and national groups who have an interest in Christian healing ministry and the pursuit of health in mind, body and spirit. We are concerned with well-being in its widest sense, and so there will be some common ground with other approaches to healing and wholeness. The Guild has always sought to work with medical professionals and health practitioners. It is ecumenical, inclusive, and has a real focus on prayer. At the heart of all Guild activities is a desire to ground our work in the mission of God. We pray for all Guild members daily, and we know that many pray for our work and for the Holy Spirit to guide us in bringing health and healing to all. The Guild aims to spread the good news about healing, holistic living, and the abundant life we have in Jesus Christ. Let us pray. We gather today to give thanks for the gift of creation and for the opportunities that each one of us is given. We come with our own needs and our worries. We come with our deep gratitude for the gift of life, so often taken for granted. And we come seeking peace for the world and to recognise the need for wholeness of our own bodies, minds, and spirits. Holy God, we give thanks for your love, mercy, and compassion, which is there for us in abundance if only we reach out to accept it. We thank you for the deep knowledge that we are all loved, and we are all your children, connected and gathered into one in your loving arms. We thank you that we are able to ask questions of you in our search for answers, and most of all, we ask for the grace to listen. We thank you that our lives are not problems to be solved, but journeys to be taken with you, Lord, as our friend and our guide. We pray for our church throughout the world. We ask to feel the wind of the Holy Spirit as it blows, bringing fresh life, inspiration, and healing. In this journey, which is one of change and disorientation for many of us, we ask for an inner renewal of energy, purpose, and hope. We ask that as we trust in you, Lord, we will acknowledge and voice our emotions in prayer and see our anxieties replaced with peace and love. We pray for strength and sustenance for all our churches and for all our leaders. We pray for the health of our world, our peoples, and our planet, for those who suffer at the hands of others, and for nations who are in war or conflict. We pray for those who are struggling to keep businesses running, for a balance to be struck between health promotion, the economic situation, and the spiritual needs of us all. Blessed are you, Sovereign God, gentle and merciful. Your anointed Son brought healing to those in weakness and distress. He broke the power of evil. He set us free from sin and death, that we might become partakers of his glory. Remember in your mercy all for whom we pray. In the fullness of time, complete your gracious work, that we may be restored in your image, renewed in your love, and forever praise your great and holy name. We pray for healing and peace, for all those who are ill or suffering in some way. We bring to you all those who are on our minds at this time. We remember them to you by naming them, either out loud or in the silence of our own hearts. We pray for those who are caring for vulnerable people. We pray that they will have the ability and strength to provide compassionate care, and that they will themselves have good health and get sufficient rest. We give thanks for all organisations whose mission it is to help to bring your love and healing to our world. God of heaven, we rest underneath your mighty wings of love. We dwell within your gentle heart. We know that there is healing in your touch. Through the sufferings of Christ, we ask for restoration and we trust in your goodness. You are our God and Saviour, our healer and our friend. We shelter within your gentle embrace. May you be wrapped up in God's love, found deep in his everlasting wings, carried and kept, safe and cherished. And may the healing power of Jesus Christ breathe across your being now. Amen.
Greetings, friends, and blessings in the name of Jesus Christ as we connect like this in worship and in prayer and in that divine togetherness as we just acknowledge the presence of God in our lives, God Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. I love that picture of the Trinity as the divine dance, that relationship that's going on all around us. And we just simply join in, don't we, the work of the kingdom, and we do what we can to be the hands and the feet and the voice, the body of Christ. And I just wanted to grab a few moments. I'm in the foyer of the Salvation Army, and you'll see a display behind me that's in our foyer, and it picks up the I Am sayings of Jesus. You'll see some of them there, including this one here, I am the true vine, which I think speaks into this theme, abiding in Christ. Jesus said, I am the vine and you are the branches. And we're also told in the scriptures that we're special, aren't we? So each one of us as Christians are a member of the special branch. I always wanted to be a policeman. Yeah, but we are a special branch. And if we remain united, abiding in Jesus Christ, we will bear fruit. That's what Jesus said. We will bear fruit for the kingdom by the way we speak, by the way we act, by the way we live. And I have a picture of this abiding in Christ image of a plant, of a tree with its roots going deep. Drawing sustenance, drawing life, drawing energy so that it can grow in the right way and bear fruit, which forms more seeds, which forms more seeds and more fruit. And this thing goes on, all because we have faithfully abided in the love of Christ. So what do we do to stay attached? What do we do to continue to remain in the vine? Well, the image came to me of four aspects of Christian faith that you'll know, but I think what we can do is just as individuals take a little stock check and say, how am I doing? Is that branch united? Am I abiding in Christ with these branches? The first branch is prayer, and we thank God for the opportunity of praying together. And as we talk like this, I'm sure you're being prompted to pray. Mark 1 verse 35 says, very early in the morning, Jesus got up. He probably yawned because he was human, and he went to a solitary place, we're told, and he prayed. Now, if Jesus had to pray to his Heavenly Father for guidance, for help, for direction, for discernment, bringing his joy as well as his anxiety to the Lord, then how much more do we have to pray to our Father in heaven to be like Jesus? That's our desire, isn't it? So Lord, help me, help my friends listening to be more like Jesus, to remain united, abiding in Christ through the branch of prayer. Lord, we thank you for prayer. Prayer is the Christian's vital breath, says one songwriter. The second branch that helps us to remain united is the branch of Scripture, the branch of the Word of God. Psalm 119 verse 105 says, thy word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path, a light that guides and directs, that shows up the darkness, shows up the obstacles that we need to avoid or get round or get over. Light keeps us safe. And the Word of God is a light, is a lamp for us. And we thank God for the truths of his Word as we read it. We have an advantage, don't we, over the prophets of old. God spoke to them at a particular time, for a particular purpose, for a particular task. But we have the Word of God 24/7. Yeah? If you want God to speak to you, then we pick up his Word and we turn to his word. Thy word, a lamp, a light. So how's the branch of the word going? Are you abiding in Christ through his word? I hope so, I pray so. So prayer is one branch. The Bible is another branch. Another branch, I think, is fellowship. I know. Fellowship. Hebrews 10 verse 25 says, don't give up the habit of meeting together as some are, but let's encourage each other and build each other up, for the day of the Lord is getting nearer. Let us not give up the habit of meeting together. Well, that's been really hard, hasn't it, in these days. We've not been able to physically gather, but the church is not closed. We've simply reimagined and used creativity and innovativeness to connect in different ways. And wow, God has blessed that, hasn't he, in ways that we would never have imagined. So many churches are testifying to the fact that more people are joining them for worship than ever, through online, through Zoom, through FaceTiming. At the Salvation Army, we've had a Zoom sanctuary evening where people connect to study the scriptures, and that's been wonderful. We've also had Zoom worship, and there's been some really precious moments. I think it's called spiritual digitalness, or digitally spiritual, I don't know. It doesn't matter what it's called. People have been connecting in the power of God. They've been abiding in Christ through online and social media means, which is wonderful. We give the glory to God. Friends, keep connecting with others. We need each other. The Bible is full of the togetherness of God, the Father, Son, and Spirit. And you and I need that divine togetherness. People to add to our lives, and people that we can add to their lives too. And fellowship is a real gift, isn't it? The gift of believers, the gift of people who have been an example, the gift of peace of people who come alongside and cheer us on and encourage us, as that scripture said, Hebrews 10 verse 25, and we build each other up. I love that image of building, isn't it? One brick on its own can't do a lot, but one brick joined to another, joined to another, joined to another, cemented together, joined to another wall, joined to another wall, a roof goes on top, and we have a warm, secure, safe place that is a haven for people to live in and abide in. And I think of us as a fellowship of God's believers. On our own, we can't do much, but we can do something. But joined to another, joined to another, joined to another, cemented in the love and the power of God by the Holy Spirit, we can be a refuge, we can be a sanctuary, we can be a place of safety and comfort and reassurance and encouragement to others, and we can help them to abide in Christ. Wow. Hey, so that's three branches, isn't it, that help us: prayer, the scriptures, and fellowship. What's the fourth branch? I think it's witness. Yeah, Acts 1 verse 8, Jesus says, you will receive power when the Holy Spirit comes upon you, and you will be my witnesses. And it's wonderful that the Holy Spirit empowers us to be a witness. And every member of God's body can do that, can be that light that shines for Jesus as we abide in him and shine for him. We're joined to believers all over the world, aren't we? Men and women, boys and girls who know Jesus, who love Jesus, in so many denominations. Denomination is not in the Bible, is it? We are one in Christ, a fellowship of believers. And we thank God that he uses our witness. For as we talk about Jesus, as we naturally talk about Jesus, as we shine for him, he uses us to make a difference. And I'm reminded of the words of Mother Teresa: preach at all times, and if necessary, use words. So friends, how are you doing? How am I doing? As we've had a bit of a stock check on our abiding, I hope and pray that today God would help me and God would help you to continue to abide in him, not least through the branch of prayer, of Bible study, of fellowship, and of witness, so that as we connect with him in those ways, we draw life and energy from him, so that we can be rooted and established in the love of Christ and abide. I can't help but think of that wonderful hymn that's sung at the cup final, or at least maybe the first two lines are. But I pray it now for you and for me and for God's people everywhere in these days. Abide with me, fast falls the eventide. The darkness deepens, Lord, with me abide. when other helpers fail and comforts flee. Help of the helpless, oh, abide with me. Friends, be blessed, be encouraged, be inspired. Those words of Jesus, I am the true vine. I am the true vine that gives life. Let that fill you with joy today as you continue to be a steadily growing follower of Jesus, making a difference for him, giving the glory to him as we abide in him. God bless you.
Abide with me, fast falls the eventide, the darkness deepens, Lord, with me abide. When other helpers fail and comforts flee, help of the helpless, oh, abide with me.
Hear, O Israel, the Lord is our God, the Lord alone. You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your might. Keep these words that I am commanding you today in your heart. Recite them to your children and talk about them when you are at home and when you are away, when you lie down and when you rise. God of Abraham, abide with us so that your commandments may always be in our hearts and souls. Strengthen us to see all who love your law as brothers and sisters. We ask this in the name of Jesus, who abides with us still. Amen.
Swift to its close ebbs out life's little day. Earth's joys grow dim, its glories pass away. Change and decay in all around I see. Thou who changest not, abide with me.
Have you not known? Have you not heard? Has it not been told to you from the beginning? Have you not understood from the foundations of the earth? It is he who sits above the circle of the earth, and its inhabitants are like grasshoppers, who stretches out the heavens like a curtain and spreads them like a tent to live in, who brings princes to naught and makes the rulers of the earth as nothing. Scarcely are they planted, scarcely sown, scarcely has their stem taken root in the earth when he blows upon them and they wither, and the tempest carries them off like stubble. To whom then will you compare me, or who is my equal, says the Holy One? Lift up your eyes on high and see who created these. He who brings out their host and numbers them, calling them all by name, because he is great in strength, mighty in power, not one is missing. God of all creation, abide with us, so that we may be wise stewards of the earth which you have blessed us with. Strengthen us to unite our voices and hearts with others who praise you for your goodness. We ask this in the name of Jesus, who abides with us still. Amen.
I need thy presence every passing hour. What but thy grace can foil the tempter's power? Ooh.
You are a chosen race, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, God's own people, in order that you may proclaim the mighty acts of him who called you out of darkness into his marvellous light. Once you were not a people, but now you are God's people. Once you had not received mercy, but now you have received mercy. God of our belonging, abide with us that we may know our connection in Christ and in one another. Strengthen us to afford all of God's children the dignity of light, and help us combat the darkness of racism, bigotry, homophobia, and transphobia. We ask this in the name of Jesus, who abides with us still. Amen.
I fear no foe with thee at hand to bless. Ills have no weight and tears no bitterness. Where is death's sting? Where grave thy victory? I triumph still if thou abide with me. This is my commandment, that you love one another as I have loved you. No one has greater love than this, to lay down one's life for one's friends. You are my friends if you do what I command you. I do not call you servants any longer, because the servant does not know what the master is doing. But I have called you friends, because I have made known to you everything that I have heard from my Father. You did not choose me, but I chose you, and I appointed you to go and bear fruit, fruit that will last, so that the Father will give you whatever you ask him in my name. God of love, abide with us, so that we may know you have chosen us to be your own. Strengthen us to show your love to the poor and the marginalized, that all may share in the fruit of your kingdom. We ask this in the name of Jesus, who abides with us still. Amen.
Hold thou thy cross before my closing eyes. Shine through the gloom and point me to the skies. Heaven's morning breaks and earth's vain shadows flee. In life and death, O Lord, abide with me.
Hello, my name is Father Sean and I represent St George's Catholic Church in Sproston in the north part of Norwich, and this is our contribution to the Ecumenical Chain of Prayer for 2021. We have been reflecting on the conversion of St Paul and then his life and missionary ministry in the early church, and how his conversion gave Paul a zeal to preach the gospel, to preach the love of God that draws all human beings, the whole human race, into a greater unity in God. As we pray together across today for unity amongst Christians, let us ask God to grant all of us some of that zeal and courage in our daily lives as Christians. So let us pray. Let us pray for all Christians renewed by the light of the gospel, that we may commit ourselves today once more to work for Christian unity. Lord, hear us. Let us pray for a deeper sense of our own calling by God and for a fuller understanding of the implications of such a call. Lord, hear us. Let us endeavour to listen more attentively to the scriptures and to allow our hearts to be touched by God's word. Lord, hear us. Let us pray today for peace throughout our world and ask that God will empower each of us and our communities to be true instruments of his peace. Lord, hear us. Let us pray too for the Holy Land of Jesus' birth and ask God that the conflict there may give way to reconciliation and peace. May justice be established throughout the Middle East and indeed throughout our world, and may all peoples of all religions and none live together harmoniously. Lord, hear us. We are brothers and sisters sharing a common baptism, worshipping one Heavenly Father, and so I invite you to pray with me the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Amen. Here at St George's, we've made a little video for you, in addition to this video, and we'd like to share it with you now. God bless you all. My child, you do not know me yet, not fully, not as fully as I would want to be known. Yet I know you as fully as you can possibly be known. I know you're resting and you're rising. You're going out and you're lying down. I perceive your thoughts and am familiar with your words even before they are formed on your tongue. For I created you. I knit you together in your mother's womb, and you are wonderfully made. Nothing about you is hidden from me, even when you try and hide the truth from yourself. I know what has been your past, and I can see mapped out your future. I am he who has rescued you many times. I am not some distant and angry father, but the utterly complete expression of love. And I love you. How I desire to lavish my love upon you, and hope that one day you might learn to love me back. Every good gift that you have comes from my hands. Ask, and I would give you even more. I love you so much that I would give up my throne and die for you, if that is what it took, if that is what you asked of me. As much as I then love you, my child, I ask all of you, my children, to love one another, to give rather than to take, to keep giving, even when the other is full and you think you have nothing else to give. As I would choose to serve you, I ask you, my children, to serve each other, to take the lesser seat, to put the other first, to think not of yourself, but of your neighbour, to stand not on what you perceive to be your rights and dignity, but to be ready to discard them at once, if it meant you could uphold and restore the rights and dignity of others. In short, what I wish for you, my child, my children, is that you would be like me, and so much so that the world would see me for who I am, and you for who you are. For you are nothing less, than my children, and I am your Heavenly Father.
John 6, verses 1 to 13, taken from the Message. Jesus went across the Sea of Galilee, some call it Tiberias. A huge crowd followed him, attracted by the miracles they had seen him do among the sick. When he got to the other side, he climbed a hill and sat down, surrounded by his disciples. It was nearly time for the Feast of Passover, kept annually by the Jews. When Jesus looked out and saw that a large crowd had arrived, he said to Philip, "Where can we buy bread to feed these people?" He said this to stretch Philip's faith. He already knew what he was going to do. Philip answered, 200 silver pieces wouldn't be enough to buy bread for each person to get a piece." One of the disciples, it was Andrew, brother of Simon Peter, said, "There's a little boy here who has 5 barley loaves and 2 fish, but that's a drop in the bucket for the crowd like this." Jesus said, "Make the people sit down." There was a nice carpet of green grass in this place. They sat down, about 5,000 of them. Then Jesus took the bread and, having given thanks, gave it to those who were seated. He did the same with the fish. All ate as much as they wanted. When the people had eaten their fill, he said to the disciples, "Gather the leftovers so nothing is wasted." They went to work and filled 12 baskets with leftovers from the 5 barley loaves.
Miracle from Holy Ground by Neil Painter and Helen Boothroyd. The first to come out of the crowd as the sun goes down and touches the hillside with expectancy was a small guardian of the future with trust in his eyes and hope in his hands. In him, Andrew sees something of himself, meets a memory, a shadow of long ago, when he was a boy, his energy unsullied and his vision clear. A whisper from the depths of his being about fairness and sharing and simple answers. A disciple in an impossible position, reminded of his first care, to feed others, wondering about miracles. A boy bearing food, risking ridicule, trusting the bread of life. Here, now, late in the day, they make their gentle way to one whose work is in such small but costly acts, who sees in each hungry face an undying melody, an essential fragility, a childlike joy not wholly lost to a bigger future. And so, in this once upon a time moment, the story begins. Outrageous hope, outspoken love, justice and joy released like nudging angels amongst people longing for comfort and community, sensing the beginnings of friendships, wanting touch and affirmation. Child, disciple, and the one who understands about just and equal sharing, know there will be enough to go round. Refuse to say it can't be done. So it happens. The great feast. Hearts and hands, baskets and pockets open. Neighbour gives bread and peace to neighbour. Each makes a place for another. And in this most ordinary of miracles, all are fed.
In the Darkness of the Night, a hymn by Margaret Lisa, used as a prayer. Let us pray. In the darkness of the still night, in the dawning of the daylight, in the mystery of creation, Creator God, you are there. In the breath of every being, in the birthing and the growing, in the earth and all its fullness, Creator God, you are there. In the homeless and the hungry, in the broken and the lonely, in the grieving of your people, Creator God, you are there. In the tears and in the heartache, in the love through which we serve you, in the anguish of the dying, Creator God, you are there. In our hearts and in our thinking, in the longing and the dreaming, in the yearning of our heartbeat, Creator God, you are there. In the love for one another, in the sharing of our being, in the receiving and forgiving, Creator God, you are there. In our joys, our hopes, our healing, in awakening to revealing, in your call and our responding. Creator God, you are there in our prayer and in our service, in our praise and in our worship, in your love that is eternal. Creator God, you are there. May all come to know that you are there, providing and sustaining us in our need, today and every day, through the gift of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord and Saviour. Amen.
In 1 Corinthians 15, verse 14, St. Paul famously stated that if Christ has not been raised, then our proclamation has been in vain, and our faith has been in vain. It is therefore a useful reminder for us to reflect on Paul's statement this week, as we remember that despite our many differences, we are all united together by the good news of Christ's resurrection. We are broadcasting this to you from St. Peter Mancroft Church in Norwich, from the northwest side of the church, right next to our Easter tapestry. The tapestry is of probable 16th century Flemish origin, where right at the centre we have the figure of Jesus walking triumphantly out of the tomb next to some sleeping Roman soldiers. It may have been the Easter Day altar frontal woven in the parish by refugee Flemish weavers. This does locate the makers in Norwich, and in this week for Christian Unity, there is something I think to draw out about this, about the welcome and opportunities offered to refugees fleeing persecution and celebrating the gifts that they brought. Back in the 16th century, a time when religious turmoil in Europe and across the world was at a height, we have here an instance of one Christian group from one country making a religious work of art, which is then either as a gift or as an item for sale given to another Christian group native to another country. It speaks to us of the global and diverse body of Christ, full of different traditions and tribes, with a variety of different ways in which we express our faith. But it is at the same time full of people, inspired by the same gospel, by the same faith, and belief in the same God, who, having died for our sins, then resurrected and walked out in triumph from the tomb. But looking to the right of Jesus' exit from the tomb, We also have depicted in this tapestry an image of the risen Jesus alongside Mary Magdalene. Here we have Jesus dressed up to look like a gardener, reflecting on the verse in John 20, saying that talks about a weeping Mary Magdalene, assuming that the man talking to her was the gardener. Of course, Jesus was not likely wearing a hat and holding an agricultural tool as depicted here, but it is instead meant to be affirming of how Mary would have perceived Jesus when he spoke to her, her, of course, then not knowing who he was. We have here in this scene, I think, a complementary image to the resurrection depiction for us Christians. When we worship, we do so in so many different ways and have many varied encounters with God. We may find this in our hymn singing, or our praying, or in receiving communion. And this image affirms this idea. We may come to seek God and find God in different ways, but it is the same beautiful and wonderful Creator of all that in our different forms of services we come to meet, to commune with, and worship. Let us therefore come together as Christians in our own ways and in our own places to pray for greater unity between us to the same wonderful God who we are united together by his triumphant resurrection from the dead.
And so we come together in prayer, bringing all our own thoughts, feelings, and the many different ways in which we abide in Christ. And as we do so, you will hear the words from the hymn, Abide in Christ, This Highest Blessing Gain, a hymn about our experience of Christ and our fellowship with him. Abide in Christ, this highest blessing gain. Each day sweet fellowship with him maintain. Abiding, he and we are joined as one. In constant fellowship, all barriers gone. Abide in him, anointing then will flow. In fellowship, the Spirit's lead will know. Obeying, we his riches apprehend. Led by the Spirit, we will be his friend. Abide in him, the light of grace will shine. In fellowship, all shadows will decline. Obey the light, his life in us will grow. From darkness freed, our heart will comfort know. Abiding, we are strengthened with each breath. In fellowship, his life will swallow death. Abiding, all our sighing turns to song. In fellowship, our heart is gladdened, strong. Abiding, this will Satan's strength disarm. In fellowship, the world will lose its charm. Abiding, we sin's power need not fear. In fellowship, the self will disappear. Abiding, thus conformed to him will be. In fellowship, his life fills constantly. Abiding, we experience his power. In fellowship, his riches hour by hour. Abiding, Lord, for thee my spirit yearns. In fellowship thy spirit in me burns, that all my being may be lost in thee, and with thee mingled through eternity. Amen. And so we bring together this reflection and this time of prayer using the words our Saviour taught us as we pray. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen.
As we gather here in St. Mark's Lakenham today, we remember and give thanks for our sister churches in Lakenham and Tuxwood, St. John's, St. Paul's, Ipswich Road URC, and New Hope Christian Centre. We look forward to a time when we will be able to celebrate the major festivals together again.
A reading from Luke. He was praying in a certain place, and after he had finished, one of his disciples said to him, "Lord, teach us to pray, as John taught his disciples." And he said to them, "When you pray, say, Father, hallowed be your name, your kingdom come. Give us each day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins, for we ourselves forgive everyone indebted to us. And do not bring us to the time of trial."
Lord Jesus, your entire life was prayer, perfect harmony with the Father. Through your Spirit, teach us to pray according to your will of love. May the faithful of the whole world unite in intercession and praise, and may your kingdom of love come. Amen. Amen.
From the introductory notes we read, "Abiding in Christ, we receive the strength and wisdom to act against structures of injustice and oppression, to fully recognize ourselves as brothers and sisters in humanity, and to be creators of a new way of living, with respect for and communion with all creation." In the Lord I'll be ever thankful, in the Lord I will rejoice.
Look to God, do not be afraid. Lift up your voices, the Lord is near. Lift up your voices, the Lord is near.
The trumpeters and singers joined in unison, as with one voice, to give praise and thanks to the Lord.
United in praise, we join together to worship our glorious God and proclaim his righteousness.
Lord of heaven and earth, we praise you for your holy truth.
which shows forth the way for nations to treat all people with integrity and fairness. As you have ordained praise as a weapon to silence those who stand against your ways, may our worship together silence iniquity and halt the works of injustice.
We worship you,
our holy Lord.
We pray for his kingdom on earth.
May his justice set the captives free, and his righteousness reign forever. Amen.
United in outcry, we join together to speak challenge to the compromised and to proclaim the righteousness of God.
Stir us with a resolve not to be silent, to speak out against the abuse of power, especially in our homes, to speak up for those who have been pushed down in any way, to speak to the needs of those who are suffering at the hands of another. We pray in the name of Jesus Christ, who extended his forgiving hands to all.
We worship our holy Lord. We pray for his kingdom on earth.
May his justice set the captives free, and his righteousness reign forever. Amen.
United in compassion, we join together to comfort the suffering and proclaim the mercy of God.
Living Word, give us your compassion to speak words of comfort to the troubled.
Lord,
give us your words of life.
Living Word, give us your insight to speak words of encouragement to the weary.
Lord, give us your words of life. Living Word, give us your mercy to speak words of relief to the suffering.
Lord, give us your words of life.
We worship our holy Lord. We pray for his kingdom on earth. May his justice set the captives free, and his righteousness reign forever. Amen.
United in faith, we join together to prophesy God's righteousness and proclaim the favour of God.
May our voices ring out through the world, proclaiming with faith the favour of God, who sent his Son to bring sight to the blind and to set the captives free. May our voices ring out through the generations to prophesy the growth of God's kingdom, established with justice and righteousness from this time on and forevermore. We worship our holy Lord. We pray for his kingdom on earth. May his justice set the captives free, and his righteousness reign forever. Amen.
Jesus calls us to abide in him as branches of the true vine. He calls us to bear the fruit of God's healing and reconciling love. He calls us to draw closer to God and to one another as we offer this love to the world. In the Lord I'll be ever thankful, in the Lord I will rejoice.
Look to God, do not be afraid. Lift up your voice as the Lord is near. Lift up your voice as the Lord is near.
With the words that Jesus taught us, let us now pray together.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power and the glory, for ever and ever. Amen. Spirituality and solidarity are inseparably linked. Prayer and action belong together. When we abide in Christ, we receive the spirit of courage and wisdom to act against all injustice and oppression. We say together,
pray and work that God may reign.
Throughout your day, let the word of God breathe life into work and rest. Maintain inner silence in all things, so as to dwell in Christ. Be filled with the spirit of the Beatitudes, joy, simplicity, and mercy.
Be one, so that the world may believe. Abide in God's love. Go into the world and bear the fruits of this love.
May the God of hope fill us with all joy and all peace in faith, so that we may abound in hope by the power of the Holy Spirit. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Hello. Welcome to my part of the Week of Prayer for Christian Unity in Norwich. My name is Reverend John Potter, and I am a minister of the United Reformed Church, serving in a group of churches across Norwich and the surrounding area. Let us pray. We worship you, the one God, God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, God of Catholic and Protestant, Orthodox and Pentecostal, God of individual relationship and common faith, God worshipped in every language and in each land, God worshipped in ornate ritual and in quiet simplicity, God worshipped in soaring cathedral and in mud brick hut. The same God, their God and our God, always, everywhere, one God. You'll notice that this video may be a little bit different from some others that you've been watching. I've taken a golden opportunity, seeing as we won't be gathering in person in the cathedral to pray together this time, of actually showing you some photographs, the reason being that I'm a very keen photographer. I also have a great passion for rainbows, as you can see. And I think they have a lot to tell us about our oneness in Christ. The reason being that a rainbow is in fact just part of that one beautiful source of light. And on occasions, when we're lucky, you get to see the detail of them, and you get to see the different parts of light. Just like all of us, joined and reflecting in Christ's one pure, true light, but doing so in all sorts of hues and shades and variations. And in actual fact, that is one of the great gifts from God, of all being together, all one, but all very slightly different. We can see that wonder out and about in nature, and the thing is that we have to keep our eyes open to see it, enjoying the variety that God made for us, and occasionally we get those beautiful glimpses of it, which, when we come to our faith, is one of the joys of the week of prayer for Christian unity. I particularly like this picture, not that the foreground is very interesting. I saw it earlier on this year, but the rainbow seemed to be stretching right over the top of Norwich from near where I live on Eaton Rise. Maybe that has something to tell us about this particular week of prayer for Christian unity, of how God's love spans the whole of this city of ours. And that indeed is my prayer for all of us. And finally, the last picture. I've added some words to it, for indeed, we do need hope as we emerge gradually from all of the complications of trying to keep each other safe through coronavirus. And the cross, well, that was made by a couple of former Christmas trees that we had at Ipswich Road United Reformed Church. And the rainbow is a real one. I just hurtled out of the mats one day, camera in hand, and was lucky enough to see it. And that is what we all look forward to. The hope of our Christian unity. The hope of our life in Christ. Let us pray. Your people, glorious God, are one people. Your people, glorious God, are multicoloured diversity. Your people, glorious God, are a holy people. Your people, glorious God, are worshipped across the world. Your people, glorious God, share the light of Christ. We glory in sharing the gift of belonging. Amen.
Hi there, it's Pastor John Norman here from Soul Church in Norwich, and so honoured to be part of the ecumenical chain of prayer. And I think this is the final link in the chain, so I hope it's a good one. Happy New Year, 2021. Year of blessing, favour and opportunity in front of us. I know 2020 wasn't an easy year for many of you, but I'm believing that God is going to do some great things through this coming year. I'm really excited. And we're going to finish off this chain of prayer really talking about the subject of unity. And I love the scripture in Psalm chapter 133. I'm just going to read it to us before we unpack it for a few moments. It says, "Behold how good and how pleasant it is for brethren to dwell together in unity. It is like the precious oil upon the head, running down on the beard of Aaron, running down on the edge of his garments. It is like the dew of Hermon descending upon the mountains of Zion. For there the Lord commands the blessing now and forevermore." I love talking about unity. You know, we're living in a world right now which seems so segregated, divided, separated. And I want to encourage us that God wants to put things together again. God wants to bring unity in families, unity in relationships and friendships. And, you know, unity, when it's working, it flows down. And when it flows down, it touches everyone, as we see in these scriptures. It flows down the beard of Aaron and onto every area of your life. And I believe as church leaders, dads, mums, we need to protect unity at all costs. Our world is just so divided in this present time. But unity is actually a gift from above. And, you know, when it comes to gifts, we need to protect them. We just celebrated our daughter's 9th birthday. And, you know, children, they are very protective when it comes to their gifts, their presents. And I've got a 6-year-old son. But what I noticed as my daughter was unwrapping her presents on her birthday is she wasn't just grateful for them, she was protective of them. Why? Because she didn't want my 6-year-old son, Justice, getting hold of her slime, which I bought her for her birthday. I mean, who enjoys slime? Well, our kids do. And you know, unity is like that. It's actually a gift from God, and we've got to protect unity at all costs. And I want to just share really, really 3 simple quick thoughts around how we protect the gift of unity. First of all, I believe unity is very, very closely associated with peace. And we've got to choose peace at this time. You know, often the path is the path of least resistance to unity. And someone, you know, someone says something, someone does something, and I don't know about you, but it's so easy to get offended these days, isn't it? You know, and we've had a lot of us have had a lot of extra time on our hands during lockdowns and all sorts of things, and our world is so disunited at the moment. But I want to encourage us in 2021 to choose the path of peace. Because I believe that when we choose the path of peace, it runs down into unity. How do we choose peace? Well, one of the ways to choose peace is choose to forgive. I know that a lot of us can get easily hurt and we've been wounded. And often it's the people closest to us that can sometimes hurt us the most. If we're going to live unified, if we're going to live in unity with one another, we've got to choose peace. And by choosing peace, we choose to forgive. 2020 was a tough year. A lot of pain and disappointment in people's lives. We can choose to hold on to the pain of 2020, or we can choose to head into a new year of blessing and favor. But I believe it begins by letting go of some of the baggage of the previous year, by choosing peace. The second way that we can protect this gift of unity is to spread peace. We've got to choose it, and then we've got to spread peace. And there's a lot of people spreading a whole lot of stuff right now, and stuff that divides us, conspiracy theories, and all so much that's going on around us. But I want to encourage us to look for opportunities over the next week or so as we head into this amazing year to spread peace. You know, people are so divided, whether it's Brexit or COVID or vaccines, and the world is so divided right now. But imagine if we all made a decision to spread peace, to bring peace into every situation. You know, COVID, I believe that we're going to come out of this season and we're going to come out of it stronger. I believe for us to come out of it stronger, we've got to make a decision to spread peace. Spread peace in the office, spread peace in the home, spread peace in the playground conversation, spread peace at the checkout at Asda. You know, imagine if the next pandemic that was to hit this country, to hit this world, was a pandemic of peace. We got to spread peace in every one of our conversations, our interactions, on social media. We ask ourselves, is this spreading confusion, hatred, or is this spreading peace? Because what happens when we spread peace is we build unity. So we've got to choose peace, we've got to spread peace, and finally, we've got to receive peace. I love that scripture in John chapter 14, verse 27. In the words of Christ, he says, I'm leaving you with a gift. I love gifts. Peace of mind and heart. And the peace I give is a gift the world cannot give. So don't be troubled or afraid. Peace is a gift. Christ wouldn't have said the word peace in that moment because it's a Hebrew word. And the Hebrew word is a word that maybe you're familiar with, the word shalom. And shalom means far more than peace. It means completeness, safety, soundness, prosperity, health, tranquility, contentment, and unity. What a powerful word. So today, my prayer from Soul Church, wherever you're watching, whoever's receiving this today, is that you would receive the Father's shalom. We can experience shalom, peace, contentment, even unity in the midst of uncertain times. I don't know what 2021 will bring. All I know is even if there are some more storms brewing in the future, we can live with this sense of peace. As we choose, and as we spread, and as we receive, I believe the outcome, the fruit of this, will be unity in our lives. Let me pray the blessing over you as you receive this word. May the Lord bless you. May the Lord keep you. May the Lord cause his face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you. May the Lord lift up his countenance upon you and fill you with his peace. Amen. Thank you for this opportunity to share. I pray you'll choose peace. I pray you'll spread peace. And I pray you'll receive peace. And as you do that, I believe that we will be more unified in this season. God bless.
That brings us to the end of our chain of prayer for this year, the theme of which has been abiding in Christ. And we hope you have received both help and inspiration from the services. Many thanks to all our participants for their excellent contributions, and we look forward to seeing you in 2022 on Thursday, the 20th of January, when hopefully it will once again be possible to hold the event in a church.